So this is kind of interesting if you're a little science geeky. CERN, the big Hadron Collider in Geneva, has been working on this for a while. Evidently, they did it, and now they're all excited that they found the God particle. And evidently, you know, well, this is the foundation of the world. This is how it all started. And a lot of people are thinking, well, what does this do for religion? And the answer is, if you're a thinking, logical, strategic person, absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. That'd be like saying, well, I looked on my wall and I finally discovered that it's paint. Somebody used paint. Oh, well, then obviously nobody built the wall because there's paint on it. It just doesn't work that way. You'd say, well, obviously somebody did build the wall and this is what they used to build it with. So, logic, reason, and strategy, my friends. All right, so yes, there is a new pope. Yeah, Pope Francis, Jesuit. And he was born in Argentina, however, he is an Italian. So there's two sides of the equation that are pretty excited about that. And they're saying that he's a very humble pope, and he's the man of the people. And he even slipped out and visited a regular church this morning for mass or whatever. So everybody's kind of getting excited and rallying behind him. And it was something else to watch this whole process go down on the news. I was watching, I went back and forth between CNN and Fox, not an endorsement of either one, just because I wanted to see the video feed. And the people on Fox were almost crying. It was crazy. They had a Catholic priest who was a correspondent. Actually, he's on their staff as a correspondent. And he was almost in tears. And then Megyn Kelly was their anchor back in the New York studio, and she's Catholic, so she was getting all emotional about the thing. So it's all, you know, I don't know. It is what it is. I'm not a huge fan of the Catholic Church. Not that I don't like Catholics. I love Catholics. I love all people. I want everybody to come and reason together. But the Catholic Church itself is not such a, I don't know. We'll just stay away from religious arguments today. Anyway, there is some related controversy to this pope already. Huffington Post has picked it up. Blacklisted News has picked it up. Daily Mail's picked it up. Turns out that when the pope was a high-ranking official in the Society of Jesus of Argentina, a military junta was installed in South American country in 1976, according to the Los Angeles Times. There were a series of kidnappings where two priests were kidnapped, and in May of that year by the Navy. And it surfaced 5 months later, and the Times reported that a 2005 lawsuit accused the now Pope of unspecified involvement in the abductions. So already controversy surrounds the Pope. If you're a Catholic, what does this mean to you? I would love to really know. I would love to know how this impacts, because when you watch the footage from Italy, everybody's crying and there's people in the street. Oh, this is wonderful. This is awesome. We needed this father, and he's our new father, and all that sort of stuff. And to me, that kind of amplifies why I'm not a fan of the Catholic Church. I guess we are going to get into this. The Catholic Church tells itself that it was the church that was started by Jesus, and, you know, Peter was its first pope, and obviously those things are not true. Matter of fact, there's more and more evidence suggesting that Peter didn't even go there. But that's for the archaeologists to figure out. Either way, it is not the church that they started. The Roman Catholic Church is pretty much the result of Constantine. Constantine is this guy who pretty much muddied up the water for the entire Western civilization in terms of Christianity. He took away what it was, what it meant. He edited out holidays, traditions, rituals, sacraments. He just edited everything out. He took what the first century church was, changed it to fit sun god worship, and then away we go. Matter of fact, there is a statue of Jupiter in the Vatican. And they decided, and I mean, the statue's been around forever. Everybody knows it's a statue of Jupiter. The god Jupiter, not the planet. And over the years, the Vatican has just decided, well, we're going to say that that's a statue of Peter. Oh, well, you know, isn't that interesting that we can just say, yeah, that's a statue of Peter. And then they have the courtyard of the pine cone, And you might be thinking, well, what's the significance of the pine cone? Well, the pine cone is also found on the staff of the Pope, and it is part of pagan sun god worship. You know, that's why they have the evergreen tree. The pine cone comes from an evergreen tree, and we could go into this for days, but suffice it to say that their seven flavors are messed up in what their religion is. And for a lot of Catholics don't even realize this. A lot of Catholics don't even realize that the staff that the Pope carries behind him has a snake as part of the staff itself, that the halos and the sunbursts throughout the Catholic Church is actually a reflection of sun god worship. It's not a halo. It's not the divinity shining forth. It's none of those things. And because there are developed answers, the people who don't want to think through the process just kind of tell themselves, well, they have good answers for why. And this is what my bishop says, and this is what my priest says. Well, they've had about 1,800 years to come up with really good answers. It doesn't mean they're right. It just means they've had 1,800 years to develop really good answers. You could give any defense attorney in America 1,800 years, and by the time we get to the end, he's going to have a really good defense for the murderer, isn't he? It doesn't mean it's right. So just like we look at politics, just like we look at the fiat currency and the Federal Reserve, it comes down to that same sort of logic, reason, and strategy applied to your faith. And of course, you know, we have hit on the holidays in the past. We had a Christmas special, and we've had an Easter special, talking about how these holidays that are very important to the Catholic Church are actually anti-Christian. If you are saying that you're a follower of the Messiah, if you believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, then obviously you want to avoid things like Christmas trees, especially like when Jeremiah, the book of Jeremiah, warns against taking a tree out of the woods, putting it in your house, fastening it to the wall, and decorating it with silver and gold balls. And then they say, well, no, that's how we celebrate the birth of our Messiah. It just doesn't work. It doesn't float. And I think that's why it's so exciting to see this transition in the faith of America. Now, if you're an atheist listening to this, just, you know, put all these little arrows in your quiver as wisdom, so when you have conversations with other people in America who do happen to have faith, you are armed and ready. But I think this is why we're seeing such a transition when it comes to faith in America. Because the same people who are realizing, wait a second, my dollar says note. This has nothing to do with money. It's not money. It's debt. Well, that same sort of thought process that gets you to realize, wait a second, I need to seek out the truth, is the same thing that is now happening in religion. And there's an article, maybe we'll bring it up in the next segment or so. There's an article talking about how faith in America is at an all-time low. And I have to tell you, that doesn't surprise me. And in a sense, nor does it really disappoint me. And I know that might sound really odd, and somebody's going, what? Are you really saying that people shouldn't go to church? Well, yeah, I'm saying they shouldn't go to the wrong church. Matter of fact, we will talk about that. Don't go anywhere. Back right after this. So get this. This is an article out of Huffington Post. The number of Americans who claim to have no religious affiliation is at the highest it's ever been since data on the subject has been recorded, which, by the way, started in the 30s. Sociologists from the University of California, Berkeley, and Duke University analyzed the information from the General Social Survey and found that the number of people who do not consider themselves part of an organized religion has jumped dramatically in recent years. Back in the 30s and 40s, the number of nuns, N-O-N-E-S, not, you know, the ladies with the habits. The number of nuns, those who said they were religiously unaffiliated, was about 5%. And now it has increased dramatically. So, what does that mean? Why are people leaving the faith? What's the point behind this? And, you know, this is actually news relevant because that's exactly what you're going to be hearing in the news over the next two or three days. Oh, is this new election of the Pope going to bring people back to the faith? And in reality, what's happening is people are going to misunderstand the data, I think. When you have a show on the History Channel like The Bible, which was the number one show on television, period, 50 million people. Now, to give you a comparison, Big Bang Theory, which is the number one show on television for its demographic, the 18 to 49 year olds, they're lucky if they pull in 20. So this is 2.5 times larger than Big Bang Theory. So this show, The Bible, pulls in 50 million people. Now, obviously, the people who tune into this know exactly what they're getting. It's not a secret. They're not like, huh, I wonder if this is going to be a situational comedy about two guys who buy a dog and name it Bible. No, everybody watching knew what this was going to be about, and they watched anyway. So what does that mean? It means there's a curiosity out there amongst the people, a lot of people. So is the desire to be religious gone? No. But the association with a religion is gone. And we can look at why. A lot of it has to do with this seeker-friendly, tickle-their-ears sort of phenomenon where you have pastors with ripped jeans and frosted tips and manicured goatees just to look cool in order to attract people into their church, which is just absolutely ridiculous and has backfired tremendously. You have this tendency to say that you're teaching people how to live according to the word, and yet they take out $2 million loans to build new churches, and the number of churches declaring bankruptcy right now is at a record number. You have this other phenomenon where people are actually starting to look for the truth. And they come looking for it. And the thing that floors me is people who come looking for religious spiritual answers are coming looking for something other than what the world is offering them. And then when they get to the church and the church tries to be so worldly, why do you think they would stay? You're offering them what the world is offering them. I know, it just doesn't make sense. So when people come to a church and, you know, Easter's coming up, so we'll use that as an example, and they ask questions about the new faith, and it's good to ask questions. So they start asking questions like, okay, Pastor, well, what about Easter? What's that all about? Well, you know, Jesus died and he was buried on Friday, rose on Sunday, and the Bible said that he was there for 3 days and three nights. And then they raise their hand and say, wait a second, wait. I know that I am not happier than Eddie Money running a travel agency, but I can count. I love that commercial. But I can count to three, and I realize that there are not 3 days and three nights between Friday and Sunday. Well, don't question it. That's just what we learned. Well, when you start digging, where did you learn that? Well, we learned that from the Catholic Church. Oh, interesting. And who taught them that? Well, that was Constantine and his mother. So you have this phenomenon where people are saying, wait a second, I want to believe in a God. I love the idea of realizing that there is a creator. The more science unpeels the onion here, we start to see the fingerprints all over the place. So I want to figure out who this creator being is. But then you go into a church where all you have to do is do a Google search and figure out that Christmas has nothing to do with the birth of Christ. It has to do with the winter solstice and pagan god worship and Yule logs and even Santa's elves. Look at what Santa's elves really are in Europe. It's just freaky. So people are starting to say, okay, well, I'm out of here. And then they have nothing to go to. They have nowhere to search out the truth in an organized structure, so they're just out there on their own. And then when movies come along like The Bible on the History Channel or Passion of the Christ by Mel Gibson, they flock to them thinking, well, maybe this will enhance my search and solidify my faith. And all of you who go to church, you know exactly what I'm talking about. People will come into a church, stay for 8 to 12 weeks, and then leave, and you never hear from them again. Why? And part of the other, or another part of the reason also, is that you don't address solutions for the people who come to you as churches. An interesting phenomenon in the Bible, when Jesus was out doing his ministry, he healed people and then he preached to them. He fed them and then he preached to them. We don't do that in church. Matter of fact, we do the opposite. We ask for the money and then we preach to you a little bit and then ask for more money. And then before you leave, we ask you why you're leaving. Oh, there's something wrong. Let me see if I can fix it. And it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. Churches should be kind of like a gym for your soul. When a couple comes to a church, you don't wait until there's a marital problem to get them into a marriage class. Do it now. Well, Josh, we're already married. I don't care. You want to stay married? Great. Well, then come to Marriage Mondays or whatever. And start teaching them about money. The world is teaching them the wrong thing about money, which is why, like we discovered yesterday, most Americans have no retirement plan. American savings accounts are in the negatives. But unfortunately, what do we teach? Once they get to church, what do we teach them? Go to school, go to college, get a good job, get a mortgage on your house, get a debt on your car. Oh, and by the way, the Bible says, you know, don't participate in debt, don't be in debt. But pay not attention to the Bible, even though that's the book we follow here at the church. And then you wonder why they're in the same financial position, and you wonder why tithing is down. Gifts and offerings are down. Because nobody has anything to give. And then they say, well, you know, we listen to our Heavenly Father. We are about His kingdom and His message. Oh, wait, except when it goes against global warming, because according to our 501c3 status, we can't preach anything political. And now the EPA is getting involved. I'm not kidding. You can look it up. EPA involvement in church. So now the government's starting to want to control the message coming out of there too. But wait a second. I thought you answered to God. Well, God and Obama. And not exactly in that order either, is it? And it's so bad that there are even some politicians that are pushing the idea. Now, it's not a bill yet, but they're pushing the idea of making sure any message that goes over 250 people be approved first by your regional government official. Huh. And you wonder why people are leaving. We'll be back right after this.